Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. And at question number one, I call Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what work it's doing to ensure that teachers get permanent contracts.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
While the employment of teachers is a matter for local authorities, we are providing them with an additional £145.5 million in this year's budget to protect teacher numbers. This provides assurance of dedicated funding and should remove any uncertainty as a barrier to councils employing staff on permanent contracts.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I have raised this issue on behalf of one of my constituents, and I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's acknowledgement of the importance of this matter in ensuring the best possible teacher resource in our schools. Scotland has the lowest pupil teacher ratios in state maintained schools and the highest qualified teacher starting rate in the UK. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the need to continue to prioritise these matters to ensure teachers get the support they need to provide an excellent teaching environment in our schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much agree with the sentiment behind the member's question. And as the member has alluded to, the government continues to value our teaching profession. That is why we have the best paid teachers in Scotland compared to anywhere else in the UK, and of course the lowest pupil teacher ratio. But there is more we need to do, and I am determined that we will make progress in relation to closing the poverty-related attainment gap. That is why we have provided that additional £145 million in this year's budget to protect teacher numbers. I've just come from a very instructive meeting, actually, for the members' information with the EIS, talking about this very issue and some of the solutions they've come forward with around about how we might be able to better provide protection in this space. There are various practices, it should be said, in relation to teacher recruitment across the country. I know this from experience, but it's really important, I think, that our teachers who are supported through their training by Scottish Government are also able to flourish in teaching careers. And that's why this issue remains a real focus for me. I've asked the Strategic Board for Teacher Education to provide me further advice on this. We'd be happy to write to the member with more detail to provide her constituent with.
Question number two, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how a public health approach to justice can reduce crime and make communities safer.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, our vision for justice emphasises the importance of the public health approach to justice and community safety. Evidence shows community interventions can be more effective in reducing reoffending and assisting with rehabilitation, leading to fewer victims and safer communities. Health considerations are also key, and we know that those in the justice system often present with high levels of vulnerability and have complex needs. So ensuring access to health and other support services at each point in the justice system is therefore vital and requires a holistic, multi-agency approach, as well as a focus on prevention and interventions which facilitate those links.
Ruth Maguire.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Justice is, of course, largely devolved. However, we see in some of the most challenging issues facing society, drugs, gambling and organised crime, Scotland is limited by Westminster law and policy, and creative, focused approaches can be stifled. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that this is just one of the many reasons that the people of Scotland would be best served by the restoration of Scotland's independence and the full powers and responsibilities that that would bring?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, well said, Ms Maguire. Independence would, of course, allow us, for example, to further embed and extend our public health approach to justice and violence reduction into currently reserved areas like gambling and drug policy reform. As an example, with full powers under independence, future Scottish governments could consider a range of measures to tackle gambling-related harm, such as raising the legal age of gambling or reviewing how gambling appeals to young people. And in relation to drug reform, any future government could consider the creation of a statutory framework for supervised drug consumption facilities, reviewing the drug classification system, clarifying clarification of the law so services can provide drug paraphernalia legally and enabling a wider range of treatment options, such as introducing drug check-in facilities as opposed to having to apply to the Home Office.
Thank you. Question number three, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of any reduction in the number of taxis in Glasgow as a result of the introduction of the low emission zone in June 2023.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The number of licensed Glasgow City Council taxis has reduced from 1,390 in May 2023 to 1,347 in January 2024, but this reduction can be attributed to declining public demand for taxis rather than as a direct result of the low emission zone, as Glasgow City Council offered a 12-month exemption to LEZ penalty charges for their fleet from June 2023 to June 2024. Glasgow City Council has announced that they will offer a further extension to the exemption for some taxis beyond 2024, where taxi operators can demonstrate a commitment to retrofit or purchase compliant replacement vehicles.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but the fact is that there are still hundreds of black taxis that are non-compliant with the SNP's low emission zone in Glasgow. It means they risk going out of business when the exemption ends next month. And back in February, Brian O'Hara of the Glasgow Taxi Credit Union said the lack of exemption for taxis risks putting 400 small businesses out of business. This could all be prevented if the exemption for the taxis that aren't compliant continues. So I have one simple question for the Cabinet Secretary. Will she back extending the exemption for these taxis, not the 76 that are already exempted, for Glasgow's black taxi drivers?
Cabinet Secretary.
So if the member was listening, that's exactly what Glasgow City Council are doing. They're offering a further exemption should there be a demonstration that there should be retrofitting planned. Bearing in mind that, unlike other major cities in Glasgow, in Scotland, Glasgow City Council does not have an age limit on taxis. As a result, there is a higher proportion of older non-compliant taxis specifically in the Glasgow fleet. And she will be aware that the LEZ retrofit fund is currently open for applications and provides up to £10,000 towards the cost of retrofitting a taxi.
Brief supplementary, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With regards to the Glasgow low emission zone, can the Cabinet Secretary say what the preliminary indications are on the impact of the LEZ on air quality in Glasgow in contrast with the level of air pollution in the city prior to its introduction?
Cabinet Secretary.
So as it takes many years for fleets to adapt to LEZ entry standards, the improvement is spread over a long period of time ahead of LEZ enforcement rather than overnight when enforcement commences. And in 2018, Glasgow Hope Street recorded an annual average nitrogen dioxide level of 61 micrograms per cubic metre. In 2023, it recorded an annual average nitrogen dioxide level of 39 micrograms per cubic metre, which is below the air quality objective limit. And furthermore, the highest daily average level in Glasgow Hope Street has fallen from 108 micrograms in 2018 to 72 micrograms in 2023, and the highest hourly level in Glasgow Hope Street has fallen significantly from 310 micrograms in 2018 to 124 micrograms.
Brief supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The reality is that the cost of renewing a taxi to be compliant can be £60,000 to £100,000. The £10,000 grant is simply not sufficient, particularly when a lot of these taxi drivers are approaching retirement age or in their 50s and can't take out that huge amount of finance. Will the Cabinet Secretary review the financing arrangements available for people to scrap and retrofit their taxis?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, clearly, we pay a lot of attention to the four LEZ local authorities as the three that are about to commence their LEZ and Glasgow City Council who have commenced their LEZ, and the plans for this have been in place for some significant time. I've mentioned why there is more of an issue in Glasgow, because they do not have licensing like other councils, where they have in other councils improved and insisted on an improvement in their fleet. As I've said, Glasgow City Council has announced that it will offer a further extension to the exemption for some taxis beyond 2024 June, where taxi operators can demonstrate a commitment to retrofit or purchase compliant replacement vehicles. And clearly, in terms of the finances for those individuals, an engagement with Glasgow City Council will help, I'm sure, to scope out requirements.
Question number four, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to address any issues in relation to the presence of reinforced, autoclaved, aerated concrete in the college and university estate.
Mr Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has confirmed via the Funding Council the extent of reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete in the college and university estate, including information on planned remediation and related costs, the measures in place to ensure the safety of staff and students, and any plans implemented to ensure that students' welfare and learning is not affected. We continue to work alongside the SFC to provide advice and support to institutions as they undertake the necessary works.
Kumara.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Now, I know he is aware that RAC was found in the Kingsway campus of Dundee and Angus College last year, and vital safety work to replace RAC panels and make buildings safe could cost as much as £12 million, and it has to be completed within 3 to 5 years. In a letter from the Minister to the Principal in December of last year, he revealed that the Scottish Government would not commit any money whatsoever to the replacement of RAC in the college estate. He knows that colleges have no means by which to borrow money or to raise money. Amid the chaos of the last 2 weeks, Presiding Officer, the publication of the Government's infrastructure investment plan has been delayed yet again. So what on earth does the Minister suggest that Dundee and Angus College actually do?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I met the Principal and Chair of Dundee and Angus College a couple of weeks ago, and I was given an initial broad understanding on their thinking on future estate provision, taking account of RAC, but also the age of the buildings. As Michael Mara knows, that is an issue at the Kingsway. And I look forward to their progressing those what are aspirational and creative plans to bring forward for possible consideration by the SFC and the Government, although he will appreciate that, given my constituency interest, I would not be involved in any such process.
Let's pick up the pace, colleagues. A brief supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 7 of Scotland's colleges have RAC. Audit Scotland's 2022 report said colleges are already £321 million short of what they need in capital funding, and no funding has been provided to date to rectify the RAC. Can they take it from the Minister's answer that he's just given, that Scotland's Government will provide no financial help to Scotland's colleges to deal with RAC?
Minister.
Well, that was a brave and bold intervention from Mr Kerr, given that his government stated that they would spend whatever it would take to address RAC, and yet we have heard not a whisper from them. There is no indication of any money being provided this government in order to tackle this very substantial issue.
Question number 5, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Jenny Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is working to increase the number of rapid-charge EV points.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Thanks to investment by this Government, Scotland has almost 5,000 public EV charge points and is on target to have 6,000 by 2026. This is in addition to the 20,000 domestic and business charges funded by the Scottish Government as part of the wider charging mix. Scotland also has the most rapid charge points of any region in the UK per head of population. In 2023, I announced the publication of Scotland's vision for public EV charging, highlighting the need for transition towards a network largely financed and delivered by the private sector. And in 2024, the private sector is forecast to invest £40 to £55 million in public EV charging in Scotland, and this Government is investing £30 million through our EV infrastructure fund, prioritising those areas of Scotland that are less likely to attract private investment, including rural and island communities. And, Presiding Officer, on May the 1st, I was pleased to launch BT's first ever pilot in the UK in Haddington, using converted green telecom cabinets on our streets to support on-street charging points for houses without their own drives and in outer areas of town. And that's another great example of partnership work with the private sector on EV chargers.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. In Inverclyde, we've got very few access rapid charge points, and some of them are currently out of use, and I feel this is certainly putting some people off moving to electric vehicles, in addition to some of the parking available within the constituency. You actually have got limited parking, so once again that actually has an adverse effect upon people with electric vehicles. But does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that we do need to increase the number of EV charging points, in particular the rapid charge ones, to show that the infrastructure is very much fit to manage the expected increase in usage of electric vehicles over the coming years?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, indeed, and reliable and convenient rapid charging is critical to support EV adoption. We're already seeing a significant growth in rapid charging across Scotland, and thanks to the Scottish Government's early intervention, Scotland now has that largest public EV charging network, one of the largest in the UK. But we need to build on that strong foundation at pace and scale to meet future needs, and that's why through our EV Infrastructure Fund, we have been supporting local authorities, including Inverclyde, to continue to grow the number of EV charge points available. And local authorities like Inverclyde understand their local needs best and will play a crucial role in that future expansion of EV infrastructure. And on reliability, last year the UK Government introduced regulations requiring all public charge points to meet specific reliability standards, and I would encourage all charge point owners to ensure that they comply with this regulation and provide EV drivers with the reliable services that they have the right to expect.
Let's keep questions and responses concise, please. I call Pauline McNeill, question 6.
Should get them.
Sorry. Just give me a minute, Ms McNeill. Can we have Pauline McNeill's microphone, please? Okay, I call Pauline McNeill. Bear with me, Ms McNeill. Ms McNeill.
Apparently it's a coup. Third time lucky. To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to issue guidance to schools encouraging them to prohibit the use of mobile phones by pupils.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
As confirmed in my statement to Parliament on the 12th of December 2023, the Scottish Government will shortly publish updated guidance for schools regarding the use of mobile phones by pupils. As a starting point for this guidance, headteachers should be empowered to take any action they deem necessary, including banning mobile phone use, should they see fit. Indeed, many headteachers have already chosen to do so within their school communities.
Pauline McNeill.
In secondary schools, the behaviour most commonly reported by staff as having the greatest negative impact is pupils using mobile phones when they shouldn't be. People commonly assume that phones, smartphones are only a problem in secondary schools, but one of my constituents has raised concern about his child's primary school, and the school has had problems with inappropriate content being circulated on WhatsApp groups, bullying via smartphones. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell me if the Scottish Government is looking into the extent of cyberbullying taking place in Scottish schools and what policies are being considered to meet this problem?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question, and she's right to highlight the issues in relation to primary school, and that was a key finding from the BISA research that the government published in November. Of course, the government has a number of policies in regards to anti-bullying, which we take extraordinarily seriously, and I think it's worthwhile putting on the record that in the coming weeks, following the publication of the mobile phone guidance, we will publish an updated national action plan in relation to some of the challenges we are seeing in our schools at the current time on behaviour, and I think through that work we would seek to ensure that any of our bullying, anti-bullying policies are updated as a result. But it's worthwhile recording some of the real challenge here in relation to mobile technology, which I would also observe is not just an issue in relation to our schools, it's an issue in relation to our discourse in the Parliament.
Question number 7, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what percentage of Historic Environment Scotland properties remain partially closed, subject to safety checks.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The work on the properties in care is ongoing, and consequently the position is constantly changing. So in order to provide the member with the most up-to-date figure on sites that remain partially closed, I've asked Historic Environment Scotland to write to the member directly with a full response.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Last week I was told that 90% of Historic Environment Scotland sites had reopened fully or had partial access. And we're all aware of sites in our constituencies, and of the 30 in Dumfries and Galloway, 5 currently have no visitor access, which has a significant effect on the tourism economy. According to a whistleblower with NHES, they dispute the 90% figure, claiming that more than 200 sites still have serious high-level masonry issues that would pose a real threat to the public, and they express concerns in the long-term future of these buildings. They insist that they're not even halfway through. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to provide evidence of where the 90% figure came from and for a reassurance around public safety?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank Finlay Carson for his follow-up question. I hear the concern that he raises. As I mentioned in my previous answer, Historic Environment Scotland will be writing to him directly, and should he have any further issues or concerns, I've given him an assurance that I would welcome a follow-up discussion about that answer. We're all committed to safety at historic sites and their speediest reopening, and having accurate information serves all of us in that purpose.